Welcome back to True Believers in the Road to Hell. We're here with Linda Vanzi, and former judge Linda Vanzi, but she's informed me that we should call her Linda, which I'm happy to do. So Linda, thanks for being here again. I appreciate your information. I wanted to go back and ask you a little bit. We touched on this in the earlier segment, and I promised that because it's so interesting, I wanted to get to your attitudes about things that aren't legal so much, or not American, United States legal anyway, in terms of your background and your growing up. You're being raised in you said you were born in Pakistan. You were a Pakistani citizen before you became an American citizen. And you said you lived in Hong Kong for a while. And let's see, where else did you?
Singapore and London.
Singapore and London. Okay. So you've had, gosh, I mean, that's just such a, I mean, I know anybody who even travels a little bit, you know, your eyes are opened by just seeing how other people live, of course. And let me just ask you about wherever you'd like to pick in terms of what you learn and what you follow. For example, you're born in Pakistan. How long did you live in Pakistan?
I lived there until I was 12. And intermittently, we traveled to London, and I went to school in London. And then went to Hong Kong and was in Hong Kong for a few years. And then we moved. My dad was the Southeast Asian Bureau Manager for UPI, for United Press. And then we were in Singapore then. That's where I graduated from high school.
Wow. Yeah. What language did you grow up speaking?
English, but with a very heavy British accent. And it was one of those things that when I was going to become an American, I literally sat with books trying to have an American accent. You know, we didn't have much TV because in the 60s and 70s, there was no TV. I think in Singapore, we'd get 2 hours of TV a day. And it was usually 20-year-old Andy Williams and Dean Martin shows. I just read books and try to get, my mother tells me that, you know, I have no class at all because I worked to get this really awful East Coast accent. But here I am.
Yeah. So what year was it that you came to the United States?
To live, I came to college. I was 16 and I went to college in New York. I really wanted to go to Berkeley, which is where my dad had gone to college. But they weren't about to let their 16-year-old kid, you know, go to Berkeley in the early 70s. So I went to a small Catholic college in New York instead.
Uh-huh. Okay. Well, I just imagine, because when you talk about this, and I just see from, you know, very sketchy versions of what's going on in other parts of the world. And when I think about Pakistan, I think about, well, there used to be East and West Pakistan, I know, for one thing. And then they had Bangladesh. And right. Then I see that there are militaristic goings on, and juntas and coups and assassinations and so forth and so on in various places. And I don't know how distorted my view of those events is, but I imagine they must have a special place for you when you see things going on in these places that you used to live. Am I right about that?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, and not just those areas, but really all of, you know, well, outside of this country, I think we take for granted a lot of what democracy has to offer. I lived under military rule when I was there. You know, I remember looking over the balcony and watching military parades and tanks and things go by. I remember frequent skirmishes between India and Pakistan and having to hide under desks because bombs were being dropped during the war in the mid and late 60s. And it was ever changing. And I don't know, you know, like I said, I went to school with the Bhutto children. I knew my dad was very, very good friends with Bhutto, who ultimately got hung. when there was another military coup. He said it was the biggest mistake he ever made by bringing in this one military general to work for him, who ultimately took over and then hung him. You know, and to be witness to that sort of thing, I think, makes you realize how lucky we are in many ways here. You know, and I mean, Pakistan is a place of tremendous poverty and tremendous difficulty in a lot of ways. You know, I grew up with people who had some money, and that can make all the difference, you know, going to private schools and things like that. You know, Singapore, by contrast, was a place that, I mean, it's nothing like the movies that you watch now about Singapore. In fact, my dad's office was in the Raffles Hotel, which was completely run down, you know, at that time. And Singapore was a perfect place for a kid to be growing up.
How did you get to Singapore?
So my dad was with UPI. We were in Hong Kong, and then he got he was the Southeast Asian Bureau manager in Singapore. And I should step back and say I was very lucky, because my parents were very committed to raising all of us in the communities that we lived in. So we didn't live in American communities. We went to British or local schools. We lived in local communities. And the Chinese and the Tamils and the Malaysians, those were our friends. You know, they weren't some little American school that we went to. I went to an American high school because at that point, my parents realized I'd probably be coming to the United States at some point. But, you know, it was also the height of the Vietnam War. And my dad refused to go to Vietnam during that time. He only covered the rest of Southeast Asia. But our house was filled with journalists, you know, the Sidney Schonbergs and the other journalists who were in Vietnam, Cambodia, Laos were coming through our house all the time. So that influence and that history, I saw it from a very different angle, from a non-American angle, from an angle of people, right, who were afraid of a domino theory and were glad that the Americans were doing what they were doing.
Yeah, that was, well, why did your father refuse to go to Vietnam?
Because he didn't want to get killed. Too many of his journalist friends died, and my father his family was more important to him than getting a Pulitzer Prize. My very, very first job ever, and pretty much I just filed papers, was working for Sidney Schonberg, who got the Pulitzer Prize for he actually was the guy who did the killing fields that got all of those people out of Cambodia, and was living in Singapore with his wife and family. He was a New York Times reporter, right? And very determined. The pressure on those guys to get a Pulitzer was very great. And my dad just didn't want to be in war zones. Although, I mean, he spent time in Burma, what was then Burma, you know, where there were constant riots and things like that. My dad was also with Ninoy Aquino. Ninoy Aquino took my dad and one other journalist who he was related to on the plane with him back to the Philippines when he got murdered on the tarmac. And my dad wrote a book covering the underground of the Marcos regime. And well, that was the other thing, right? To be in Asia, seeing American influence in these other countries. I don't think anyone can appreciate in Pakistan. I knew people with arsenals in their houses and boxes, right? Boxes, just floor to ceiling boxes of American, those little green cans of food that they feed the military, that were supposed to be for the military, but were all just by people who had guns and military stuff. And that was true everywhere, right? We were supporting a dictatorship in the Philippines, and we were supporting dictatorships in Singapore.
So I didn't quite understand when you said that Aquino had your father on the plane when are you talking about the time he actually got assassinated? Murdered.
Yes,
he was there. So, your father was actually there at the time.
If you look at the video, the last shot of video of the video is when the military guys come onto the plane to escort Aquino off, and there's a guy who stands up in the seat right behind, and that's my dad. And my dad was writing the book at the time, and Aquino was wearing a bulletproof vest, And he thought that if he took these, Ken Kashiwara was the other journalist he took with him, who also happened to be his brother-in-law. And so they were on this big plane. It was just them. And the military came on, took Aquino off, and they threw some guy out of a bus who then shot Aquino in the head. Well, the military did. So my dad was there for that because there were subsequent riots and things in the streets. Wow. And the interesting thing was when my dad was writing this book, he was in San Francisco, he and my mom, he was still working for UPI. And they used to get calls from the FBI, who did not appreciate the fact that he was writing a book that was critical of the Bush administration support of a dictatorship in Southeast Asia.
Well, it just raises so many interesting questions, I think, in terms of, but what happened to your father at that moment? I mean, if Aquino is shot in the head, what, and he's standing there or he's close by, right?
So he's still on the plane.
What happens to him?
They finally let him get off. And I'll never forget, because there were no such things as cell phones then. It was in the 80s, I guess. I was living in El Paso. And I just remember my mother calling at 2 o'clock in the morning saying, Aquino's been killed. And my father then spent a few weeks just in the streets of the Philippines where there were mass riots and things like that, just reporting on it.
So he stayed there.
He stayed there. He ultimately wrote this book called.
But he wasn't. Okay.
He wasn't hurt.
They didn't like take him into custody or question him or anything because he was with Aquino?
They did not. And, you know, the most remarkable thing, and I think this is, I learned so much just being in both in the United States and, you know, in these other countries, that there are no simple answers to anything, right? We all think we have an answer and there are no simple answers. You know, my father has covered wars, riots, all over the world. The only time he ever got hurt or beat up was covering the Harvey Milk riots in San Francisco. In the United States, when cops turned their badges around, dragged him out of a telephone booth and broke three of his ribs. He never got injured anywhere else.
Why were they picking on him anyway?
Because they knew he was a journalist. And they didn't like, it must have been the after the Harvey Milk trial. It must have been after the verdict. And people were, you know, rioting in the streets of San Francisco.
What happened to your father ultimately?
He was an editor for the LA Times for a while. And he and my mom live in Sacramento now. He worked for the speaker, for the Democratic Speaker of the House, doing research.
He's alive today, though. That's good.
Yeah. Doing anti-death penalty work and things like that on a journalistic side.
What is your father's name?
Max Vanzi.
Max Vanzi. Okay. Mm-hmm. Well, Max sounds like a terribly intriguing, interesting guy. He has, lost all kinds of experiences.
So, yeah, he was, you know, he and my mom on my 18th birthday sent me a birthday card that said, you can do anything you want in this life, but always vote Democratic. True journalists. They're true liberals.
Well, talk about partisanship. Now we come full circle, right?
Right, exactly.
Well, you also mentioned, I'm going to fill in a little bit of the circle here, that you also mentioned that you lived in Hong Kong and London. And why did you live there?
Well, my dad was with, I mean, it, so
you went to school in London, as I understand.
Right. So he was, it was just through all through UPI.
So it's all following your father's.
Yeah. Work. Yeah. We were just all traveling together. I mean, we were in Hong Kong for a couple of years. I mean, you want to talk about discrimination, right? Like being a Pakistani, being in England is not such a fun thing. Most Pakistanis are either Anglophiles or South Asians are either Anglophiles or they despise the British for all the problems they've created over most of the world.
What
during
is your,
their many escapades.
Where do you fit?
I am not enamored by them. I think that the arbitrary lines that they drew in Israel, they drew in India, and what they did in India and Pakistan was a sin. You know, those battles continue to this day. And that division that they caused between India and Pakistan, between and Bangladesh, what they did to Kashmir has caused untold death to people and destruction, you know, and unstable governments that didn't exist to the extent that they have existed since 1949.
I suppose that's probably could be a subject of a whole nother podcast, right? In terms yeah. of terms of all the international failings of the Britain, Great Britain, and the Commonwealth, and so forth. But let me try to relate it back to you personally. I'm wondering how it affects this wide array of experiences that you've had. I wonder how that affects your approach to what you do. And in terms, and you know, you're not a judge anymore, but especially judging and lawyering. And how does that, if you even know, you might not know how it affects you, I suppose, but I'm wondering how it does affect you to the extent you're aware of it.
Here's how I hope it affects me, or it has affected me, given all of those experiences, for which I'm very grateful. You know, as a journalist, my dad did not have a lot of money. But he had access. I mean, we had access to all kinds of people and things, you know, and experiences, not consumer type things. That how we are in this world. I mean, I truly lived a very diverse life, you know. I and here as a judge and as a lawyer, I've been involved in a lot of training of diversity and lecturing and trying to get people to, you know, not have implicit biases. But really, when you're living that, there's less room for it. You know, my parents made me, and I have ever since, you know, I've left my house when I was 16, when I went to college, realized that I've been with rich people and poor people, people who are homeless and people who, you know, are kings. And there's really no difference. To be able to treat everybody equally, and to know that everybody's got a story and everybody's got a condition of some sort, is what I hope that I've learned. And that no matter how I do my work, that I'm aware of that, whether I'm representing somebody, whether there's somebody on the other side, that there's a human being on the other side, or when I was a judge. And not to forget that, because it is very easy to forget.
Right. Well, of course, we all have our biases and our team we play for and our clients and so forth. So, yeah, these are, I think the thing that you are talking about are things that are very easy to intellectualize and to understand in an intellectual way and less easy to live.
Yeah.
I don't know. Does that make sense to you? That
it absolutely makes sense. Yeah, and I think people, you know, I think for the most part, people are well-intentioned, but, and I'll give you, you know, maybe I would do this to a European, right? But I'm going to give you an example of something that happened at the law school. In this last graduating class, there were two East Asians. Okay, one student was a former Cambodian. Her parents were Cambodian refugees. The other one is Vietnamese. And a professor, you know, one of them goes into a class, and the professor calls the single only East Asian in the room by the name of the other person, assuming that you all look alike, right? I would never make that mistake. Now, I may make a mistake between a Norwegian and a Swede. I could never tell those people apart, you know, or, you know, maybe people from different African countries. But I think people, as well-intentioned as they are, can make really bad mistakes sometimes.
You know, one thing that occurred to me it's slightly off topic, I suppose, but it occurred to me while you were talking about the militarization of these various places and the military being involved in all the firearms. I was wondering, that seems to me it could have a couple of different effects on your view on firearms. And because firearms is obviously in the United States a huge, huge issue. If to call it a problem or not, whatever your position is, but there are a hell of a lot of firearms in this country, and a hell of a lot of people die with firearms. And I'm just wondering, on the other hand, you have governments that are defended or caused by the use of firearms. I'm just wondering kind of if that's had an effect on your view on what should happen here.
I feel about firearms the same way that when people ask me how I feel about drunk drivers. They're bad. They're really bad. I grew up, when I was in Pakistan, I used to go skeet shooting. I used to go wild boar hunting. It never occurred to me that firearms were used. I mean, unless it was in a military type situation, that firearms were just used to randomly go and just shoot, mow people down the way that we have repeatedly happening in this country. I've never seen anything the way that it is here. Now if I go, I'm always aware, like, does somebody have a gun in a grocery store? Does somebody have a gun in a movie theater? It never occurred to me to think about things like that when I was in Singapore or in Hong Kong or London. And I know those things happen still in those places, but not to the extent that they happen here.
Okay, great. Well, that's interesting. I mean, that it's interesting that you take that, I suppose, because I agree with you, but I'm thinking of how a solid right wing NRA activist might, you know, use that against you, I guess, in terms of saying, well, you know, if these governments and wherever you were, if the citizens had only been armed, you know, they'd have been able to resist the military takeover or whatever.
But that's not true, right?
I mean, you know what? But you understand the argument.
I know exactly what you're saying, but I'll tell you that that's just not true. We don't use arms here to protect our government, right? You can look at the January 6th thing. Those people think they were protecting our government, which they were not. But arms that are used here aren't for protection. They aren't for making. I mean, I don't think that there's any good use of guns. Other than, you know, people who legitimately hunt and eat what they hunt. I mean, I don't do that, you know, but, you know, I think that that's a different type of thing. But I don't think that there's any other good use for guns.
What would you do about the issue?
Not what our Supreme Court's done now. I mean, I would ban all guns. I really would. I suppose if people wanted to hunt, there are certain rifles or something, maybe you're skeet shooting, but this notion that everybody can have a gun, anybody can have a gun. And it's not even the military, it's not even the assault rifles. I think people who are armed are dangerous. I'd be dangerous with a gun. You know, people are like, well, why don't you protect yourself? I remember there was this time when I was on the district court where they were doing all this training for judges, gun training, so everybody could be armed. And I thought that was the most absurd thing I'd ever heard, right? Because what do you want a bunch of judges now trained with carrying, you know, their own little ivory silver handled pistol around?
You know, there are some judges who are armed, you know.
There are a lot of judges, and I know who they are. I know who a lot of them are.
Yeah. So judges who are with pride carry guns onto the bench, you know, and
yep.
It's again a whole nother issue we could spend a lot of time on, but in terms of other, let's turn to your work in civil rights, if you want to relate that to guns, you can do that. But let's talk about you're not on the bench anyway. So what? And you're doing civil rights work, as I understand it. Why and what does that mean to you?
So the civil rights, I think, is the reason I went to law school, you know, to begin with. I'm really interested in constitutional issues. Always have been. I'm particularly have a passion for the state constitution, which I think has not been used well at all. In fact, I've got a law review article coming up soon. I think it's being published this winter, that Mark Baker and I wrote together about how our courts have to do better with interpreting our state constitution and affording broader protection to New Mexicans, particularly given the current state of the U.S. Supreme Court, which is hell-bent on removing any rights, you know, of people of this country. So I've always been interested in it. I am doing civil rights work again. I don't tend to do the sort of prison litigation and police type cases. There are a lot of attorneys, civil rights attorneys, doing that work. They do it well. They know it. I tend to do focus more on employment, whistleblower type, you know, First Amendment type cases. The First Amendment issues really interest me. And then bigger systemic change things. I think you probably know that I wrote the dissent on the Aid and Dine case. And I hope to be able on this side to be able to litigate in that area should it come up. So aid in dying, reproductive rights, those are all areas like on a bigger systemic issue or scale that I'm more interested in.
Okay, well, let's talk about one of those. Let's talk about aid in dying. What is your passion about that?
I believe that our state constitution allows or should recognize a substantive due process right for people to choose the way that they want to die when they are terminally ill. I will always be saddened by the fact that I was the dissent on that case, and that I thought I had written an opinion that was basically handing it to the Supreme Court at the time, and they just followed U.S. Supreme Court precedent. I am very glad that Deborah Armstrong got through the legislature, aid in dying bill or life options, I don't know what they call it, bill. And, you know, through the efforts of people like Rob Schwartz and Compassion and Choices and a lot of other people, I think it's an important right to recognize. And you know, because it really impacts a small group of people who are terminally ill, which either are people, you know, either they're very sick or they're older. We don't pay much attention to that. And nobody should have to suffer. In this country, nobody should have to suffer if they choose not to.
Why is that controversial?
You know, I don't know why it's so it's controversial for the religious rights groups, very much, who believe that every life has value, right? It's the same thing with the abortion argument. Every life has value and that people should live until God wants them to die, which is, I think, a really narrow view. I think people who, and I think this really does cross the political spectrum. If you've ever watched anybody suffer desperately, who wants to die and just end it. These are not people who are going to live. They're going to die. The question is, will they die tomorrow or will they die 3 weeks from now, some truly, truly miserable death? They have to have less than 6 months to live. And I think for anybody who's actually watched anyone suffer, they would agree that this is a good option.
I guess therein lies the, I'm assuming, because I'm certainly, I don't have expertise in this at all or particular experience with it. So assuming, just correct me if I'm being naive about this, but I assume the issue lies on the definition that you just, in terms of when someone is actually terminally ill, and actually, you know, we're very, very certain they're going to die and there's no relief in sight and so forth. And therein lies the issue. Would that be right?
Yeah. And I mean, the restrictions on this have been very clear. I mean, there are several states now that have aid in dying statutes. Nobody has actually decided it on a constitutional basis. The Supreme Court of Massachusetts just heard argument a few days or maybe a week ago. And I don't know if they're going to leave it to their legislature, but, you know, it exists in California. It's existed for a long time in Oregon. I always think that the Canadian Supreme Court is so far beyond any of our courts because they've actually recognized the right to die as a constitutional protection and right. So, but all of the statutes have been very clear. You have to be competent. You have to have less than 6 months. A doctor or two have to certify that you don't have much time to live. So, for example, you have to be able to ingest the medication on your own. A doctor can't do it. So, like in Switzerland, a doctor can administer the medication, but no doctor in this country can actually do the. There can be no Dr. Kevorkian, right? Who's actually doing it? So there are a lot of protections. So if you have dementia, for example, you can't use aid in dying. Even if you know your dementia is going to be progressing very quickly and you don't want that to happen or whatever, you don't have access to it. Or let's say if you have ALS, for example, and you can't ingest the medication, you can't use that service.
Huh. Well, that's sad in itself, in a way.
It is sad in itself. It's very sad in itself. But one of the arguments from the amicus, you know, briefs that were filed in the Court of Appeals was this was going to be a method of wiping out poor communities, right? They just encourage sick people just to use aid in dying and just say, Mom, you should just do yourself in. Well, you know, states are required to keep statistics, and it has never been borne out. In fact, what the statistics show is that it's wealthier white people that tend to use this more than any other demographic. And of all of the people that actually get the medication, only maybe over a little of a third actually use it. People just want, you know, the peace of mind of knowing that it's an option for them.
So what is this an issue that you are active in some capacity now, or is this past?
I'm not active in it in any capacity in a legal way. I'll tell you that Rob Schwartz and Maureen Sanders, and I don't know if you know Frank Spring, he's an attorney.
I do.
They were very kind, and they actually named a fund after me, and because of the dissent that I wrote the end of life options, to raise money, to educate people, and also to provide medication to people who otherwise can't afford it. I think Debbie Armstrong's making it so that Medicaid will pay for the medication, but most insurance companies won't. And there are people also in far, you know, flung parts of the state who are struggling just to pay their medical bills and can't afford the medication. So I think they've helped some of those people out as well.
So what are, aside from that issue, what are other of the biggest, what do you think are the biggest civil rights challenges in New Mexico?
I think right now, I think reproductive rights is going to become a big issue.
Well, we're going to have the Mississippi abortion center here in Las Cruces soon, I think, right? In New Mexico.
But there are little counties all over the state that are trying to pass little ordinances and bills and things just within their counties to stop, any abortions or stop training or information. To let citizens prosecute like they're doing in Texas. I imagine this is an issue that will go up through our courts at some point.
Yeah, that whole Dobbs decision caused a whole ripple effect of a lot of issues, didn't it? I'm sure you're quite active with and using the New Mexico Civil Rights Act. The new law.
You know what? I haven't been able to use it yet because I'm doing employment stuff and they kept employment out of that act.
Oh, okay. So,
I'm hoping to find something soon where I can use it.
Well, do you have an opinion about it anyway? I mean, I just thought maybe you had some views on the use of it or whether it was a good thing, bad thing, or ineffective or what.
Oh, no,
too early to tell.
No, I was a very strong proponent of the New Mexico Civil Rights Act, even with some of the compromises that were made along the way. I, you know, watched all of the hearings. I participated in some of them. You know, I thought there was a really good committee, you know, headed by Justice Bosson with Mark Baker and other people on it. I think it's really important. I think that the federal courts have stripped civil rights protections with qualified immunity in a just an awful, awful way. I read these opinions and I just think, how can these judges be doing what they're doing?
It is amazing.
And I frankly think, you know, it's interesting because the U.S. Supreme Court, I think that Justice Thomas and a couple of justices actually don't like qualified immunity. But I think Justice Thomas wants to strip Section 1983 away completely.
Right. It's not right? just qualified immunity.
Not just qualified immunity. Right. My only fear here is that my desire is that people, lawyers who are using the Civil Rights Act, don't just use it willy-nilly, and that use it very sort of in a concerted and calculated way to understand the New Mexico Constitution so that protections get broadened, and that they use it in a way to educate judges, because our judges don't know anything about the Civil Rights Act, but you know, the federal or state. And it's important for them to understand, you know, to educate the judges. I tried to have a plenary session at the conclave this year, but whoever the committee wasn't, I guess they weren't interested. So it didn't happen.
Well, so if you're not using the Civil Rights Act, then what are you doing?
I've got these employment cases. Yeah, they're whistleblower and other employment cases. So I am doing those. And I'm sure a Civil Rights Act claim will come along soon.
We can hope.
You know, the other thing is, I mean, anything that happened prior to, what was it, July of this year, last year, it doesn't come under the act. So that it has to be a new violation that would come within the act's purview. So
just wait a little bit.
Just wait. Inevitably, it will happen. And I'll tell you, Mark Baker and I are teaching civil rights litigation to law students. We teach it once a year. I'm trying to teach state constitutional law as much as I can. And we're teaching civil rights litigation every year. We have full classes every time we teach it. And we hope that we are educating a generation of young lawyers who will be, who will know this stuff.
Well, I think you said, correct me if I'm misunderstood, but I think you expressed some disappointment in how the state constitution is used, because, and I'm with you, I was many years ago, of course, in criminal law, I was talking in search and seizure law, right, largely, or right to counsel and so forth, mostly criminal procedural issues, but that we lawyers, and I was always hoping that the New Mexico Constitution would be used in a more expansive way, as opposed to how the feds were cutting us down, right? So I don't know what it is you're referring to necessarily, but it's been a disappointment from my perspective in that way, because I thought there were many opportunities that we could have expanded the use of the state constitution, but.
And if anything, I mean, the only place it's really been expanded is the Fourth Amendment, right? The search and seizure. Our courts have been just abysmal in actually expanding rights in civil matters. And part of this law review article, you know, we were actually going to write about the Civil Rights Act, but decided we needed to step back. And the first thing we needed to look at is how our courts interpret the state constitution. You know, it uses this interstitial approach where you look to the feds first, and if they don't answer it, then you look to your state constitution. And we're proposing or inviting the courts to come up with a different, better analysis that's going to look at the state constitution independently of the federal.
Well, I wonder sometimes if I'm just being Pollyannish, you know, by thinking, gosh, New Mexico really is a, you know, an oasis, and where there's, we have better rights than they do other places in the country. And I'm afraid I'm a little more cynical these days than I used to be, because I think that, unfortunately, the feds ordinarily rule. It seems like, even no matter how draconian they get, I see a lot of, politicians who shall remain nameless for the moment, who trumpet the federal system, you know, is the way to go. This is the way we are. They do it in the feds. So if they detain people in the federal system, they ought to detain them in the state system too, you know. And people go, yeah, well, that's good. If you can detain people, that's a good thing. You know, if we can keep them in jail, that's a great thing. And where I always thought that, well, gosh, maybe New Mexico could be a place where we actually, you know, it's a city on the hill, right? You know, it's a shining city where they actually do things better and they actually have more freedoms. It doesn't seem to work that way.
And it doesn't. I have not seen it, and particularly not seen it in the civil context, you know. Any of the analysis that's been done, whether it was the marriage case or Aiden dying or any of those cases, has not broadened protections for New Mexicans. And I hope that you know, as we move forward, and as all rights get stripped away, because the Supreme Court's not, you know, they've just started. Let's just put it that way. They've just started their march toward utter and complete erosion of everything we know.
But you're talking about the U.S. Supreme Court.
Yeah, U.S. Supreme Court.
But doesn't that argue for states to, you know, take the wheel here a little bit? I mean, obviously we can't secede from the Union, I don't think. But we can't not honor the U.S. Supreme Court, but there's certainly things that you can do within the state. And so it seems to me what you're saying, if you take what you're saying as true, that the U.S. Supreme Court's going to keep cutting back on rights, that the states, that would argue that the states should use their state constitutions more.
I've been arguing since 1992 or 1995. I was writing articles then about how our courts shouldn't wait for disaster, right? We have a constitution that empowers its citizens, and we should be using it. We should be expanding rights across the board. And we have a pretty unique constitution and much of the language is even different than the federal constitution. You know, these constitutions that were written as people moved west are much broader than those ones that were written in Massachusetts and New York that, you know, the federal constitution was modeled after.
Right.
And we should give it meaning.
Well, let me be a devil's advocate a little bit in terms of, do you think that, you know, I've often seen that, you know, you could get public support, public support for, you know, hanging someone in the public square for jaywalking, you know, if you gin up enough, passion, you know. So I'm wondering, would you get public support? Would you have public support for that expansion of rights, you think, by the state?
So I think, two things here. I was on a call with some people yesterday with the ACLU, and they were talking about the marriage case, the gay marriage case, and how they did a lot of public education sort of trying to normalize that before it ever got to the New Mexico Supreme Court, so that the justices wouldn't be, you know, adverse to the notion of expanding that right. But I think judges, and especially justices who are dealing with constitutional issues, constitutions are supposed to protect the minority, not what majority rule is. Right. And judges and justices should be thinking about that, you know, what the protections are when they're expanding rights. You know, I don't think they should just do it willy-nilly, you know, just anybody can do whatever they want. There has to be a principled way to do this. Which is one of the reasons in our law review article that we haven't made a recommendation as to the path forward as to how to analyze these cases. That really
What is the name of your law review article?
What is the name of it? It's coming out in this winter issue.
Okay.
So,
okay, go ahead. I'm sorry.
So I was just going to say that I think public support is good, but the public isn't always going to be on the side of what people want. And who are you protecting and what are we doing? You know, this is not about like, oh, we'll expand rights if the majority wants it. If that's what you want, then you can go to the legislature and get your fix that way.
No, well, but Jen, and I, you understand, I totally agree with you, of course, because I argue minority rights routinely, but it is also, there's a political calculation, as we've said earlier, in everything, right? And so there is some kind of assessment of what people want. So,
but look, when remember in California, Rose Byrd and I can't remember the other justices ruled that the death penalty in California was unconstitutional, right? The voters threw them off the bench. That was the first time Supreme Court justices in California got thrown off the bench. And it requires a certain amount of courage, I think, as judges and justices to do what is right, to do justice. And you can't be afraid of what the majority thinks.
Well, I can't disagree with you. I'm just asking your assessment of how it, I guess the point is, it's not always easy, you know, to do what you and what you and I think is the right thing to do, you know. So, but coming back, circling back to the state constitution, well, we're saying the same thing over again. I'm just repeating ourselves, but we really think it could be used much more expansively and much more effectively than it has been.
So I think the title is Independent Analysis and Interpretation of the New Mexico Constitution. If not now, when?
Okay. Well, great. I look forward to seeing it, and we will send it to every member of the court and the legislature, right? Because they both have an interest in it. Okay. Well, I want to, I'm debating whether to take a break, but I'm going to take a break and then do a last segment of our, if it's okay with you, if you have a few more minutes.
Sure.
Because I have a few things to try to get out of you. All right.
Okay. Fair enough.
All right. We'll take a break and be back with True Believers on the Road to Hell.